selection for you this afternoon with an excellent lineup of some very influential ship owners to discuss key issues in the current markets with you. But before that, we are very pleased to have the Secretary General of the IMO with us, Mr. Kai Tak Lim. In fact, we also have Timio Mitropoulos, so we get two for the price of one, although only Kai Tak is going to speak now. Now, Kai Tak is South Korean, as many of you will know, and I would say he arrived as something of a dark horse to the IMO Secretary Generalship last year. He came in on an agenda of wanting safe, secure, and sustainable shipping. He has an agenda for constructive engagement with the industry to drive constructive regulatory reform. He was a seafarer originally. He then moved into government in Korea and had a long career working within the ports and harbours ministry. Until last year, for 3 years, he'd been president of the Busan Port Authority, which shows that he does have executive management experience as well. So, without any more ado, may I introduce Mr. Kai Tak Lim to the stage.
Thank you, Julian, for the excellent introducing myself. And distinguished the guest, and also very important, prominent figure around the world, and ladies and gentlemen, I'm very honored to be here to make the address before very prestigious participants here. And I'm advised by the Julian to make my address within 10 minutes. But my speechwriter made it for 15 minutes. Just before coming up here on my seat, I was trying to remove some part of my address. But I will try, and also I had two times address yesterday, in this building exhibition. So I was concerned about what other topics, issues I should say at the third address at this very prestigious occasion. But I will try to avoid some duplication as much as possible. Really, first of all, I have to thank the organizer of this event, the Tradewind, for the invitation to speak to you today. Also, particularly, I'd like to thank the Mr. Julian Bray, editor of Tradewind. We have known many years. So, as I mentioned, strongly emphasized in London, I'd like to appreciate the role of media in terms of the IMO work as well, so that the media is a very important to advertise what we are doing, not only toward the audience within the maritime community, but also the audience outside of the maritime and shipping communities. There are times when my job can seem a little remote from the sharp end of the shipping, a committee room at IMO headquarters, or a meeting with the National Shipping Minister can seem an ocean away from the maritime hardware of ships, cranes, dock, and cargoes. But I remain acutely aware that everything we do, everything we discuss, and everything we decide in this forum has a direct impact on the everyday world of shipping and on those relevant people. As I said yesterday at the opening ceremony, although Greece also has suffered from the global financial crisis of recent years, the country's shipping sector remains powerful and hungry hugely influential. By country of ownership, the Greek fleet is the world's largest, and it is growing too. Greek investment in the new building is very high. It certainly helped bringing down the average age of the fleet. Greek investment in shipping helps underpin the array of ancillary businesses that support shipping, from shipbuilders and equipment supplier to manpower provider, brokers, repair yards, and in the end, ship recycling facilities. At events like this, all those different sectors of this eclectic industry get the chance to meet, greet, and do business. Let me say at the outset of the business of shipping, business of shipping is not the business of IMO. The business of IMO is to create a framework of standards and regulations that enable shipping to operate safely, securely. So I would call back a little bit one line before. The business of IMO is to create a framework of standards and regulations that enables shipping to operate safely and securely, cleanly and efficiently. A framework that applies equally to all participants and which does not allow anyone to gain an advantage either by cutting corners or by imposing unilateral requirements. But at the same time, there is a strong belief within IMO that shipping and related maritime activities are essential components of future sustainable growth for the Earth's 7 billion plus inhabitants. And that belief fosters a clear understanding that the shipping itself must also be sustainable, and that means economically sustainable too. When IMO regulate about issues like how ships are designed and built, the reduction of emission, the use of cleaner fuel, ballast water management, container safety, and so on, the overarching objective is to ensure that people of the world for whom shipping is indispensable can continue to enjoy the benefits of this industry on which they rely, and in a manner that meets modern expectations about safety, environmental protection, and so on. I get a strong sense that the ship owners, by and large, understand that and are supportive. Of course, your immediate priority may, from time to time, be different from those of the organization. But as I said, when standing for election as a Secretary General, I want IMO, its member state, and industry to embark on a voyage together. And I think that's exactly what we are doing. Many of our challenges are shared, and we must help to find a solution together. In 2015, last year, for example, IMO's World Maritime Day theme focused on the vital importance of maritime transportation and education and training. This year, the latest BIMCO ICS manpower report has predicted a potential shortfall of almost 150,000 officers by 2025, which only goes to reinforce the importance of attracting new recruits to the industry and giving the skill and the expertise they need. Seafaring must be seen to appeal to new generation as a rewarding and fulfilling careers. And that means ensuring that the social and welfare and work-related expectations that young people of today have are also present within the shipping industry in terms of their career development. This is no doubt an interesting time to be in shipping. The economic climate may not be easy, and the public expectation around industry social and environmental credentials may be more challenging than ever before. But at the same time, the opportunity afforded by the new technology places shipping potentially on the brink of a new era. If we think of the technologies emerging around the fuel and energy use, automation and the vessel management, materials, construction, and so many other areas, it is not difficult to envision new generations of ships that bring step change improvement in all the areas that IMO regulate, in economic viability and profitability too. That, I think, is a part of the voyage we are taking together. The regulatory framework will lead continual adjustments to ensure that cutting-edge technology and the very latest equipment are effectively integrated into everyday ship's operation, and that the potential benefits they offer are harnessed to our collective advantages. Notwithstanding the need for occasional adjustment, the regulatory framework adopted by IMO is now quite comprehensive, and it is well understood that the development of new regulations should only be undertaken if there is a clear and demonstrable need to do so. Indeed, IMO has been actively engaged in efforts to reduce the administrative burden and the red tape associated with the regulatory compliance for ship owners and the staff. In the coming years, therefore, IMO will have an increasingly important role to play in the implementation of existing regulatory framework. That does not mean IMO becoming an enforcement agency or inspection authorities. But what it does mean is that we will be placing more and more emphasis on capacity building and expertise among those that do inspect and enforce. We will be helping countries first to build legal capacity to write IMO standards into their own national legislation, and then to implement and enforce that legislation more effectively. By doing this, particularly in developing countries, we will help to spread the benefits of participation in maritime activity more actively and evenly, and we will be able to serve simultaneously the interests of the environment, of society, and of the economy, which have been identified as the three pillars of sustainability. If we are going to succeed in all this, we need to raise our own game too. For me, an absolutely crucial element is communication. We need to make sure that the right people here understand our messages, and again, that applies just as much as to the naval architect working on scheduling for new ships, and as it does to the politician and developing national strategy for maritime development. We need to speak to them all, and that is why I'm keen to ensure IMO is an active, engaging, and outward-looking organization. IMO is the only body able to ensure that international shipping can operate safely and sustainably within the fair and equitable global regulatory regime, and the world needs it to be strong, effective. In this respect, I once again would like to emphasize that I would like to really appreciate role of media, like we are doing, organized by the Tradewind, for IMO to better communicate with outside world, including the industry. Ladies and gentlemen, in conclusion, I have said many times this year that shipping has a wonderful story to tell, but it is a story that needs and deserves a wider audience. Almost everyone in the world today relies on shipping to some extent, but very few are really aware of its values. I hope that through events like this, all those involved in this vital industry is invited to join me in spreading the news that shipping really indispensable to the world. Thank you for your attention.